Guys,
wow.
Stellan, don't go!
Here, please, Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Translation here.
Do we need to
then? It will be in English.
Yeah.
So, nachdem wir so einen schönen Fotocall draußen hatten,
so after having had such a nice photo opportunity outside, I would like to ask all of you to please sit down.
Dankeschön. Setzen Sie sich bitte, damit wir mit der Pressekonferenz beginnen können. Please sit down. Dankeschön.
The photographer will love that.
What?
The photographer will love that.
What?
You put the glass and the bottle down.
Yeah, also in the aisles, could you please sit down? Bitte in den Gängen auch sich setzen oder die Gänge frei machen. Dankeschön.
Schauspieler.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome for this press conference on the 64th International Film Festival screening out of competition, Nymphomaniac Volume 1, and please have a welcome for the producer, Louise, Vesth. Playing the part of the father of Joe, please have a welcome, Christian Slater. It's good to have you back here in Berlin. He's been here last year in competition. Now he's back on stage. Have a welcome for Shia LaBeouf, playing the Jeremy. And please have a welcome for the first. She's playing the young Joe, Stacy Martin. also a long-time companion with the festival, playing Seligman. Have a welcome for Stellan Skarsgård. I guess the last time it was Bellamy. You've been here in Berlin?
I wasn't.
Oh,
yes.
You was. Okay, but it's great to have you now here. Yuma Thurman playing Mrs. H. And I would send love and regards from to all of you from Charlotte. She would love to be here, but she's unfortunately finished shooting in Canada, is now with her family in Paris. Not unfortunately, but she sends love and regard to you. She would have been here, but we have a wonderful cast here. So we can start now the press conference. And please remember, this is a press conference about Nymphomaniac.
Hello. I have a question for actors and actresses. Some of you are working with Lars von Trier a lot of times. For some of you, it was your first time. But question for all, what is the biggest challenge in working with Lars von Trier? What is the biggest challenge for you all, personally? Thank you.
Go ahead, Stacy.
Oh, Stellan. I guess the biggest challenge for me was to be on my first film. Lars was just very kind and very trusting, so he made the job very easy. And to just have fun with it, I think, if you're going to do a film called Nymphomaniac, you have to.
Yeah, then it went to all the other actors as well.
It was too undirect the question. It was too vague, so everybody
what
managed
was the
to sneak out.
How was it?
Well, I've worked with him several times, and I don't think it's very challenging working with him. It's actually easier than with most directors, and you have a lot more fun. It doesn't even resemble work to me. Okay, Uma, what do you say?
It's one of the best days of my life.
Where's Jen?
I loved it. It was an amazing experience. He was patient, gentle. He kept telling me to slow down, which is, I guess, coming from Hollywood, very unusual. You know, they always want things to move so quickly, and it was nice to actually be on a set where, you know, there was actually some real time given to capture moments.
Shia, just you.
Sorry to leave you at the last. Okay.
Okay, a question here in front, please. Could you please stand up, Miss Engelke?
Yeah. Two questions. One goes out to Uma Thurman, one goes out to Stellan. Uma, your role, you seem to enjoy playing what you're playing there. It looks a bit like being on a stage, like being able to play theater. Maybe you can say something as far as the script is concerned, how free you were, how close you stayed to the script.
Well, for me, I mean, it was exactly scripted. Lars kept saying I was overacting, but that's nothing new. It's my pleasure.
He always says that.
It's my great pleasure to do that. But, you know, Lars wrote this really basically fantastic monologue where, you know, this woman, this fury of a woman scorned, you know, enters this room and really no one else speaks. She just keeps talking. So it was a really great challenge to sort of memorize sort of 7 pages of Lars's female diatribe of rage. And then with the incredible way that he shoots, you know, I think this, I don't know how many minutes it is left in the movie. I'm going to see it the first time tonight. I'm so excited to see everyone's, what I can expect from all of these wonderful people. And it's going to be so good. You know, for me, it was to do these 25 minute takes where, you know, I never did a movie, as Christian is pointing out. You know, this woman comes and stands in the hallway and she waits. So, of course, I'm like, let's go. You know, and so I was like, no, wait. He's like, oh. And he's filming. Like, oh, you're going to film me waiting? Okay. I've never done that before. It's like, film me sleeping. But it was unbelievably refreshing and lively and exciting to get to work, almost get to act in a way like theater or for the first time on film. It's because you never get that kind of space. So the whole thing was 25 minute takes all day long. It's quite muscular to do. It was great.
Thank you. And Stellan, we need you as the one who holds together the story. Were you aware of being the connecting part when you were shooting, or were you only inside your story with Joe?
Well, I had read the script, so I knew the function of my character. But when you're shooting, I mean, I was locked up for 2 weeks with Charlotte Gainsbourg in a room, and you can't have... life can be a lot worse than that.
But as far as the things that he was adding later, as far as those were concerned, the flashbacks, for example...
No, they were in the script. I knew them.
You knew,
I knew what was going to happen between my lines. I don't think it... I mean, sometimes I considered how to do it because of that, but yeah, in general, as Uma says, when you work with Lars, you just try things and you do whatever you want, and it's his job to put it together. So you're not too concerned with how he's going to use it.
Okay. Were you aware of the fact that there were going to be parts that might be considered humorous? Because the audience had more fun than we expected.
Well, I thought it was very funny, and yes. Uma's scene is one of the funniest scenes I've ever read.
Okay.
He's a very funny man. You got to learn to laugh at him a lot more.
There's a question on the right side, please. Could you please stand up so anybody can see you?
Yeah, I would like to ask to Mrs. Vesth, what about the cuts? Especially the second part of the movie is very cut, about 62 minutes, I think. What's in the cuts, I'd like to ask. And to the actors, I saw the movie 4 times, volume 1, and 2 times, volume 2. This movie causes addiction. What do you think about it? Thank you.
Well, you are asking what's the difference of the second part, the short and the long? Yeah, I mean, it's the first volume that we show here in the Berlinale, and we haven't announced yet when we will show the second volume on the long version. So you will have to wait and see.
It will be in Cannes.
We don't say that.
Yeah, and sorry, we're now in Berlin. We don't want to talk about Cannes.
But I guess question. You all saw the T-shirt. So we'll,
could you step on to the next question, please? Yes, your question, please.
Hi, my name is Tatiana Benza for W Radio from Colombia. A question for Shia and Stacy. When you got involved in this project, knowing there were going to be a lot of sex scenes, were you afraid it would be too much, or were you completely confident in Lars von Trier? And maybe a second question, there is a lot of talk about this film being about a nymphomaniac. Do you think our societies are maybe too conservative still about everything regarding sex in the movies?
You good? I really trusted Lars, and I've always really loved his films, so the sex scenes for me really were part of the film. And I trusted Lars and I trusted that, so immediately it makes the job much easier. And talked to Shia a bit before, it wasn't like, oh hi, we've never met, okay, let's get naked, and no. So there was a lot of discussion and a lot of preparation, so at the end of the day you end up just actually wanting to start filming, because there's so much talk and so much worry around it that you're just kind of sick of talking about it. You just want to do the scene because it to honor the film, to honor Lars, and for me that's what's important as an actress.
When the seagulls follow the trawler, it is because they think sardines will be thrown into the sea. Thank you very much.
Okay, your question, please.
Well, I'm Ibrahim Totanje. I work for Dubai Media.
So, just a second. Are we ready for the next question, please? Thank you.
No.
Welcome.
My name is Ibrahim Totanje. I work for Dubai Media, and I want to ask, this is an open question for all the actors. usually we say like the fear is the big enemy for any actor. I want to hear from you about the comfort zone of each of you while you're doing your character in this movie. How the director were pushing you out of the comfort zone, or maybe keeping you to stay into that comfort zone to be able to give the best of your acting. Thank you.
Oh, me?
Yeah.
I didn't have I mean, obviously the script is packed with a lot of
sardines.
Yeah. Brilliant. So
that's
I just
the
took
bait.
That key and I twisted it and more was revealed. And I don't really, yeah, there you go. That's it.
All in the sardine, man.
It was all just, one sardine after another. And it quelled the fears and the anxiety, and I was quite fulfilled. There we go. Yeah. I can't even remember the question, really. I don't know, but
there's the comfort zone.
But the comfort zone. Yeah, again, I think it just goes back to
the trees.
First of all, Lars is I hadn't been on a set like this before, where the director was just in just utter command of every department, and where I felt so completely safe in his hands. I think. From the beginning, from the first moment that I sat down and had dinner with Lars, I was placed in the actor comfort zone. I just felt him to be a very genuine person, a very real. I could tell just by looking at him and by talking with him that he had a very sensitive soul. And for an actor, that is like the greatest gift to get the opportunity to work with somebody like that understands what it's like to be an actor and to be put in sometimes uncomfortable, compromising situations, and know that you're there with someone that gets it and has a very kind heart.
Okay.
That's you, Stacy.
Oh, I've talked too much already. You go.
Well, I think you're talking about the actor's comfort zone, and that means usually when you mention the comfort, staying within the comfort zone means that you're lazy as an actor, that you don't take any risks.
Right.
But the thing with Lars is he makes you feel really comfortable. You feel safe with him, which makes it possible for you to take risks.
You kind of want to do anything you can for him,
yeah.
Right? Yeah. If he asks you to do something, you'll do it.
Okay. Your question, please.
Yes, Anne-Christine Oranger from Montreal. A comment to Mrs. Thurman. It's great to see you in a role that pushes everything to the limit, that really exploits your character, your talent as an actress, not just your physical talent, but your emotional talent as well. Thank you. And my question is to Mr. Skarsgård. You're sort of the healthy pole of Lars, Charlotte being the neurotic one. You know, Charlotte herself said the two characters together is him, okay? And there's this equation that's been made since thousands of years that women plus sex equals evil. And it's causing an immense amount of damage around the world, from excision to death, from honor rape, honor death. Now, is Lars trying to show us our own neurosis and trying to say, see, this is what you think. This is what your society is all about.
First of all, it's a question you should ask Lars, but he won't answer it. But I
wanted to.
But I don't think he tries to show you very much. He's not particularly out to send a message. I never heard that women and sex should be evil. I've always found most wonderful joy in sex with women. What?
She's talking about the persecution of women.
Oh, the persecution of women. Yeah. That's true. But that is one of the themes in the film is, of course, What are we allowed to say? What are we allowed to do? And are we persecuted by because of our thoughts, our wordings, what language we use, our sex, or if we live in a different way than normal people do, or that is the norm rather than the normal thing?
Mm-hmm. Question way in the back on the right side, please.
Yes, hello, this is Yanis from Greece. The question is to the producer. I would like to you to define the artistic differences between the long version and the shorter version of the first volume.
Yeah, I mean, you will have to see them to get the exact differences. I think for me it's like it goes deeper into the discussion that Lars is taking in this film. It has a slower pace. And I think then you would have seen, if you've seen both, that the sexual content is more explicit in the long version than in the short one. It's not like it's another story, it's just, it's kind of all the material that Lars wanted to use from his shooting is in the long version, and therefore you will have a deeper feeling of the topics discussed in the film.
Your question in the middle, please. Could you stand up?
Okay. Hi, I'm Pavel from RTL Television. Nice to meet you. A question to all of the actors. At first, what do you think, how important is for you as an actor, the Berlinale? Because I think it's turning to the number one film festival in the world. I think it's going bigger than Cannes, I think. So what do you think about the importance of Berlinale for you as an actor to promote your film? And the second question, a few of you would have been here before. So do you have maybe some special Berlinale moment in your memories, some very good things that happen here, some nice moments that you can share with us?
This is my first festival, so I can't answer this question.
They can all say it's today.
Look, I mean, I have, you know, look at this scarf. I clearly feel that this is, what a festival. My pocket is full of little tiny bears. And I'm just thrilled to be here. You know, again, it's, look, I'm also grateful that I came over here from Chicago and you know, I thought it was going to be freezing here as well, but it's very nice. So the weather is beautiful and you guys are all here, so it's perfect.
Okay.
Well, I love Berlin Film Festival. I don't know whether it's good for me or bad for me, but it's very nice to be here again. Hope to come back, and especially this is the first festival where it hasn't been cold, rainy, and windy.
Yes,
I've been to.
Right.
I think this is my first time at the festival, which is amazing. But it's 64 years of this festival, and now that there's a festival everywhere in the world, you can be very proud that you're one of the oldest and first. And I'm very happy to be here. Thank you.
Okay, there's a question in the middle, please. Could you please stand up? Thank you.
Hi, I'm Inge Merete Hobelstad from Norwegian newspaper Dagbladet. Congratulations to all of you on an extremely fascinating film. I have a question for Mr. Skarsgård. In your dialogue with Charlotte Gainsbourg, I get the feeling that she is sort of representing the sexual side of this discussion, while Seligman is coming with the intellectual, the artistic, the parallels to what she's talking about. Could you talk a little bit about what your thoughts were about the dynamic between them, what it is that he's offering to her story about and to the image of sexuality that's protected in the movie? Also, I have a question for Ms. Martin. What were your thoughts upon first reading the script and on the explicit scenes, and were you nervous at all about how the film would be received, being so vulnerable, I would think, as you are in the film? Thank you both.
Well, it's the two characters in that room are, of course, two sides of Lars von Trier. This one is the nerd Lars von Trier, and that's me. And the other one is the far more interesting and more multi-layered character of that is played by Charlotte. It's not a sort of simple representation, but I'm basically a eunuch. I'm asexual, and she's the opposite. I mean, it's just something to play with. But we have to understand that it's not really realism we're dealing with. It's not. You don't attack the roles necessarily as you would do a role that was not in a fairy tale, because all Lars films are fairy tales in a way, and you have to adapt to his universe.
Can you just repeat your question, so I was focused?
What were your thoughts upon first reading the script and upon the amount of nudity and sexuality in it, and were you nervous at all about the reception, being so vulnerable as I would think you would feel in scenes like that?
I wasn't nervous. I think I didn't really have anything to lose, it being my only first film, so that was pretty handy. But reading the script, it was just, I mean, I'd never read a script, and reading that script in particular was just so insightful. There's so many things, and the dialogue that he wrote is just fascinating. And it just makes you, it just made me believe in really great directors, and just, I had to jump on the train. There was, the nervousness was just more, I think, technical, the fact that it was my first film and all these other things, but the story in itself didn't particularly make me feel nervous, no.
Question on the back, in the right side, please.
Julia Albrecht from RTL2. Another question for Ms. Martin. Why do you think the life story of a nymphomaniac can be interesting for a bigger audience? So why should we all go and watch the film?
Why not? why not? I mean, that's what Lars does. He creates great conversations. He creates debate and around things that we might not feel particularly comfortable talking about, but it's important. Our sexuality is who we are, so why deny it? And it's just Lars, you have to watch his films.
Your question in the middle, could you please stand up?
My name is Mehai Sigit. I have two questions, one for Mr. Slater and a statement to Mr. LaBeouf, because I think you're sitting in his place now.
Yeah.
So I start with Mr. LaBeouf. We are journalists. We don't run after sardines. We run after a new world we want to discover. And we think in this film you can discover a lot of things that you don't see around. So I don't know why he just went away. But to you, you are from this generation that came out 20 years ago. Tom Cruise, a lot of people. What was the click that brought up all these actors in the same time? And because it was like a change of generation in Hollywood, or in films that were not in Hollywood. But so many actors came out at that time. You
sorry, can we stick to the film? Sorry, we have just one more question left, okay. So let's stay with the film. Sorry, but the last question for today, please. On the right side.
Hello, my name is Corina. This is a question for Mrs. West. Producing a movie in Germany, you always, lots of people tell you what you can do, what you can't do, what you're allowed to before they give you any money. Producing a movie from Lars von Trier, can he do anything he wants because he's Lars von Trier? Or do you still get restricted in some parts?
Yes, he has done what he wanted to until now, so let's hope that it will continue. This with the sex topic made it a little difficult because of public rules. Sex is more difficult than violence. I don't know why, but that's how it is. Hmm. And we have until now been able to do all the film that he wants to, and thanks God for that.
And thanks for you all being here, because this is a wonderful movie, also about love, most important about love, and the Berlin Film Festival is very happy to have you here. Nymphomaniac Volume 1, thanks for being here in Berlin, and have a good red carpet.
Thank you, everyone.